Just thank you, organizers, for inviting me and organizing this conference. This is a joint paper with my colleagues Martin Larsen and Anders Trolle, who both were at the time at EPFL. Now both have left meanwhile. Martin is now at ETH in Zurich, and Anders is actually at the HEC Paris. So this paper is about something we have been working a couple of years ago. We wrote a paper on a term structure, on a class of term structure models, linear rational term structure models, that we published 2017, last year. And this is a very powerful class of models. It's easy to specify. It has bounded interest rates from below. It allows for unspent stochastic volatility, and it gives you closed form swaption prices, right? Okay, and so that's the paper I'm speaking about here that was published last year. This class of models, these linear rational models, they are related to something that Xavier Gabay actually introduced and dubbed the linear degenerating processes about 10 years before, right? We were aware of that, and we even comment on this, and there is a relation between the linear degenerating process and the linear rational models. But then, you know, we really thought, after having published our paper, that now we should spend more effort and really figure out what is the exact relationship between these two, and do the fine distinction and the fine analysis. And then, you know, and then it turned out that in the context of long-term risk factorization, right, the concept that goes back to Alvarez and German, that has become very, very much discussed recently in the finance community, that in this particular context, these linear rational models play a very prominent role, compared to the generic LG process. So what are the findings of this paper, right? I mean, to put it in a nutshell and to make it blunt, every linear rational model can be represented as an LG process. So in principle, a linear rational model falls in this Gabe class of LG processes, and in a sense, vice versa, right? So these two concepts are, you know, as we will see, they are essentially the same. However, subject to a dimensionality criterion, and that we now worked out. But having said that, you know, the linear rational models are a very particular way of representing LG processes and turn out to be very important in the context of financial modeling for two reasons, right? So LR models, linear rational models, they can be easily specified, as I said. They allow for non-negative bounded below interest rates, and we have done that and carried that out empirically, theoretically and empirically in our paper, right? And second, these linear rational models, in the context of long-term risk factorization, they go very natural with this type of factorization. So, I mean, put it in different words, like every LG process under the long forward measure, I will recap the notation, but every LG process under the long forward measure is or can be represented as a lower dimensional LR model, right? So, and that kind of gives now, in hindsight, right, also when comparing these two frameworks, a clear distinction of what we have done here in the LR models. The paper, because, you know, a lot of this fine comparison is very subtle, right? The paper also gives many examples highlighting these subtleties. And that is something that I will not present here, but you can find it looking up the paper that is on SSRN and our archive. Good. So this is the outline. I will first review these concept of the linear degenerating process, Then I will introduce and review the linear rational models, and then I will relate them, and then I will relate them in the context of the long-term risk factorization. All right. So what is the scope after all, right? So the scope is, this is about, you know, asset pricing. And asset pricing on the basis of a state price density, of the specification of a state price density. So we have a, you know, filtered probability space that is kind of our model space, and that is an economy on an unbounded time horizon. And there is a reference measure fixed here, P star, is an auxiliary measure a priori. Right, this auxiliary measure is going to be, well, it is equivalent to the objective measure as well as to the risk neutral measure, but a priori can be something in between. Okay, and then there's some notation with it, right? And when I speak about the state price density here, then I speak about state price density with respect to this auxiliary measure. Okay, and I speak about a state price density which has this, which allows for this multiplicative decomposition, right? So, I mean, clearly in the context of stochastic processes, right, as well, there are things which are beyond this type of processes, right? I mean, this is in particular, this is semi-Martingale, and so I insist on looking at processes of this type, right? So it's a normalization factor times the discount factor, discounting with a risk-free short rate, and then times the density of the risk-neutral measure with respect to P star, to the auxiliary measure. And so, as you can see, you know, P star can be Q, and in this case, this would simply be 1, and this setup would just be the discount factor. And if P star is equal to P, then zeta is actually the true state price density with respect to the objective measure, encoding all the risk premia that you would collect from investing in financial risk. We'll ask questions as we go. Yes, please.
It's also a probability measure, right? So everything is a probability measure.
Everything is a probability measure. It's a probability measure, but it's good that you tell, right, that you ask, because, I mean, P is a probability measure is a probability measure, the reference measure we work with and we start with. And as it happens, because we are on infinite time horizon, you know, P and Q, a priori, they are only locally defined, right? The usual thing, right? I mean, you have a density process. I do not assume that this density process is uniformly integrable, right? In other words, right? So indeed, right? So this should be locally equivalent in that sense, right? Good. But I wipe under the table a lot of these subtleties, which you will find in the paper, though. So that's the scope, right? This is about it. And so now, you know, LG processes and linear rational models both give you a class of models for zeta, okay? And then, of course, you know, I think everybody's aware of what zeta is. When, for instance, when you price a zero coupon bond, this would then simply be the expectation of, right? Of that, right? That's a zero. That's the price of a zero coupon bond, right? You multiply the payoff at the maturity with zeta t, and then you have to normalize, right, and take conditional expectations. So that's what the state price density is about, right? Okay. So now you know. So LG process, right? So abstractly speaking, right, is now the following, right? So Gabi says, okay, let X be an n-dimensional semi-martingale coming from wherever, and then look at the pair zeta X. And this is the pair zeta X forms an n plus one-dimensional linearity-generating process, right, if, you know, these two defining properties hold. This, of course, and has to hold for all times capital T. A, B, C, D are some C1 functions. Okay, so what does it tell us, right? Looking at the zero coupon bond, right, we see that the zero coupon bond price is linear in X. Okay, that's what I state here as a corollary. But not only that, right? So actually, any claim which is linear in X will have a price that is linear in X. You see that? Okay, so this is, of course, a very convenient class or a very convenient type of framework to work with, and Gabe did a lot, you know, wrote quite a couple of quite influential papers in economics, right? In asset pricing, building on this LG process. Good. So, okay, so, but of course, you know, how is X possibly related to zeta? That is not told us at all by the definition. So let's look at another way of characterizing an LG process. It's by looking at the following. So just, you know, I mean, all I do here, I multiply on both sides with zeta small t, which I can, of course, and then I just restate these defining properties. They're there. And of course, once you write it this way, and then you look at the process that is given to us by the pair zeta and the product of zeta times x, then it becomes obvious that, you know, this process has a strictly linear drift, right? If it were to satisfy this property, this is actually if and only if, right? It's kind of a differential way. That's kind of a differential form. I mean, expressing this property in a differential way, right? Okay. So that equivalence here, modulo, you know, whether this is a martingale or a local martingale stuff, right? Which again here I wipe under the table. That's quite straightforward, right? And that's actually now giving us much. That's already giving us much more of an idea how X could be related to zeta, right? And what you would actually model. So let's even let's spin it a bit further. And you know, I state this as observations. So here is our LG process, and let Z be the pair zeta times zeta X, zeta times X and zeta. And then, you know, what? And then we see that zeta itself is just a linear functional of z, okay? Obviously. So E1 is the basis vector which loads on the first component. And the zero coupon bond prices, I just restate them here, that these were linear in X, become now linear rational in Z. That's also quite straightforward, okay? So, good. Now a couple of questions come up right at this point. Question is, you know, what if this were to be a model, right? What are we going to model? What is our factor process? What are we going to specify? Is it X? Well, but you know, specifying X comes with at least two, you know, there are at least two caveats there. I mean, first of all, X has to satisfy horrible state constraints, right? State constraints, because I mean, this bond price is supposed to be positive. Good. I mean, you can possibly, given a function B, you could possibly figure out conditions on X so that this affine, affine function here is going to be positive. But say, if you're on top of it also want to have rent interest rates bounded below, or let's say non-negative interest rates, then the bond price would also have to be bounded above by one. And then, you know, this becomes rather cumbersome, right? So, That's the first caveat. The second one is what I already mentioned before. Even if we specify X, right? But how is it related to zeta, right? There is no relation given to there. So it's not Z, right? So what about it's not X. So what about Z? Okay. Well, Z, right? Fine, right? Z is the factor process, and then we define zeta to be linearly loading on Z. That sounds like a model, but then, you know, a factor process in an econometric model, we would like to be stationary, right? Stationary, ergodic, you know, mean reverting, whatever you call it. But what about stationarity of Z? Well, Z has a linear drift, strictly linear drift, right? Now, strictly linear drifts, right? I mean, this kind of linear dynamic systems in multi-dimension, right? They're already quite hard to classify, right? I mean, right? So if the drift matrix would have negative eigenvalues only, right? Then Z would mean revert to zero, and that would certainly not be giving you a stationary model, right? So that's not something you want, but then, you know, to what could that then possibly mean revert otherwise, right? So and of course, on the other hand, right, being that zeta is just the first component of Z, and zeta in the long run should go to zero, right, actually speaks for that at least a component of Z should go to zero. So, you know, it's an issue. Good. Right? And, but, you know, now let's move a step away from it, and let's do this, just an observation, right? I just spoke about the eigenvalues of beta. But, you know, if the eigenvalues of beta were, I mean, we can inflate that by multiplying it with some exponential in function in t, right? And if doing so, right, we would of course increase the eigenvalues of the drift matrix, right? So you see, so we could make the eigenvalues here of the drift matrix really be such that some of them will have zero real value, okay? Zero real value, and then we have a chance that Z prime is going to be, you know, somewhat stationary, right? But still, it's rather cumbersome to imagine how this could become stationary. And then you know, the other thing here I say here that of course we can always rotate the whole stuff, right? I mean, this is obviously rotation invariant. There are various ways of representing this. We can just rotate with the Q on top of it, and then this representation here. Oh yeah, by the way, when we inflate that by exponential alpha t, then of course we have to deflate Z prime again in order to keep the same state price density. That's clear. And if we on top rotate that, then we have to take that into account here with the loadings, which is then not going to be the first unit, the first basis vector, but it's actually going to be some psi. Okay. So, but that, you know, that kind of brings us already closer to how one would model such LG processes, okay? It's here. But the issue remains, right? I'm not comfortable with something of this type, which is mean reverting, right? When something mean reverting, we always want to have a kappa times theta minus, right? X or Z, right? And so that's actually what we do in the linear rational model, right? So in the linear rational model, we just say, okay, let Z be something mean reverting. I write it generic here. It's not the kappa theta notation, it's the B beta notation. Okay? But it's clear that, right? If beta is negative eigenvalues, then there is the kappa theta minus Z. And so there is kind of, we will have this type of mean reversion, quite evidently. And so not only do we have now a constant B here in the drift of Z, but we also add a constant phi to the specification of the state price density, right? And both of these, you know, help us, right? Because again, so here we can easily have this specify this as a mean reverting stationary ergodic process first, and second, we can easily specify this part here such that, of course, zeta is positive. Zeta has to be positive, right? There are no constraints, but it has to be positive. It's a state price density, and that's of course easily done if, let's say, if you assume that the state space of Z is in the half space, right, which is where psi loads positively or non-negatively on, and phi is strictly positive. So that's for sure easy to be done. Okay, so that's a linear rational model of dimension m. And so what about, what about the bond prices? So what about the bond price in this model? And of course we get the linear rational expression in Z. Okay, we get the linear rational expression in Z, and so are the short rates, linear rational, okay? Good. So what do we learn from here? First of all, we have closed form bond price term structure. So this is as good as in the affine models, right? And the short rates are a function. If you look at the functions, alpha minus something which is typically convex in Z. Well, in the scalar case, beta negative, this is evidently convex. Function and this is often and it is actually often bounded above. Okay, so if we take the sup of this function over all possible values of Z, right? So we see that R will be bounded below by alpha minus this sup. Okay, and so this gives us bounded below rates. That's nice. And then, moreover, right, and that's an important observation I should have mentioned here. Moreover, we also see, and that's evident again, because everything here we do is of first order. It's just taking expectations of linear functions. So all we see here in this expression, because again, it's the expectation of something linear in Z, that it's only the drift characteristics of Z that enter this, right? So the martingale characteristics of Z, they don't show up, right? Martingale I have not specified, that can be, you know, diffusive, can have jumps, whatever, but the characteristics of the martingale don't show up, right? In particular, we are allowed to have any kind of specification of the stochastic volatility of the martingale, let's say, right? And that is, of course, very handy and very very useful in the context of term structure modeling, because it allows us to specify exogenously, right? So that's, as I said, the characteristics of M do not enter the term structure of bond prices. And by the way, Z is never be, I never required Z to be Markov, right? It will typically not be Markov, because there's typically going to be another bunch of factors, U, that feed into the martingale part of Z, right? So, and then the pair Z, U, you would then specify as a Markov jump diffusion. And U is going to afford to be unspanned by the term structure. That's how you call it, unspanned. U is not visible, right? U doesn't show up in the term structure. As a consequence, the bond market is going to be incomplete. We are not going to be able to delta hedge just using, we're not going to be hedging just using bonds, products which are volatility depending, right? And so this is giving us incomplete models, which you may or may not like. Of course, often we like complete models, but in the case of bonds, of bond markets, it's actually better to have an incomplete model, because it goes better with the stylized fact of what they call unspanned stochastic volatility. That has been reported back by Colin Dufresne Goldstein. They just empirically made these observations. Bond, you cannot replicate the straddle, a kind of a purely volatility depending derivative. You cannot replicate by solely trading in the term structure, right? And if you want to respect this stylized fact, then the model should be incomplete, which turns out to be notoriously hard in factor models other than the linear models I present you here. Just think of an affine model, exponential affine model. Because in exponential affine model, because of the convexity, right, you have nonlinear, you have this exponential function that enters up all the time in these expectations. You know, all factors will typically show up explicitly in the term structure. So the bond prices or the yield curve will be function of all the factors all the time. Even though if you want to hide some factors, it's very hard to hide factors. While here it's actually generically possible. So this is a very convenient thing. Yes?
So these models, the bond prices, they all are linear with respect to the factors. So there is huge linear dependence between the bond prices. You only need as many as the factors that you have.
Yes.
Really?
Yes. Of the Z factors.
Yes.
The Z factors. Yes. Yeah. Okay.
So it's,
sure.
It's a hugely correlated.
Yeah. Sure. Okay. Market. But that's you know that there we take again, right? You say okay, we run a PCA of the term structure, and then we see okay, three factors are explaining 99% whatever of the variation. Of course, you always aim at a parsimonious, right, model, I guess. You want to have the model as parsimonious as possible. But, all right. And what about the positivity of you know, the zeta? This is what I said, right? So you would specify Z to take values in the half space where, you know, the half space, so that psi here, non-negatively loads on, and choose phi to be strictly positive. And then because of, you know, the state price density is not normalized, right? So we can always normalize things. We can, without loss of generality, just set phi equal to 1. And then that's this supremum here that showed up in the short rate expression. Right, so this supremum here, there are easy conditions to be given. They are provided actually in the paper in case when the state space of Z, when the range of values of Z is the positive order, there are easy conditions in terms of the of the drift of Z, so that, you know, again, of B beta here, so that this, and psi, of course, that this expression here is finite. And so, and then we have bounded below rates, right? Alpha is a free parameter. We can choose alpha equal to alpha star, and then we have non-negative rates. If you allow for a lower effective lower bound, then you can choose alpha smaller than alpha star. Okay? So, and you know, and in some linear rational model with USV, right, and the stationary n plus n dimensional factor process that you can be affine or not, you know, this is actually, that's what we used in our paper. Good. All right, so far so good. These are nice models, and I hope, you know, they will be used more often in the context of modeling interest rates. Good. Now, how are these things related, right? So, I mean, I guess first thing what should be evident, I mean, the way I told you, the narrative I gave you here is kind of, we were building up. So we first I gave you LG, and then LG process, and then I told you that an LR model is adding something on top, right? Is adding some constant terms. So from this already it's clear, right? An LG process just falls naturally, is an LR model, right? Right? Right, so now that's not something you should tell too many people, especially of course not you know, not the inventor of LG processes. And so, you know, what about the other way around, right? Is an LR model, so LR, are LR models therefore kind of, is it superior, is it larger or not, right? Well, the answer is no, right? The LR models are LG processes as well. You just embed them one dimension higher and then you're done, okay? And that's what I will now elaborate on, because just I said dimension, right? So now I will elaborate on the fine differences. And when I speak about dimension here, I mean the number of components that Z has, right? Okay, the number of components that Z has, because I have never told you assume that Z takes values or covers all values in an open set in RM or something like that, right? We deliberately left that open here because it turns out, especially in the LG process case, that the typical range of values that Z will take there, right? I just sketch it here in case of two dimension. The typical range of values will be something like they will typically live in an affine subspace. So this is where ZT will live, right? So okay. So therefore, right? So typically, LG processes, even if they have two components, they will typically live on a one-dimensional affine subspace. Okay. So let's keep that in mind, right? And conversely, right, if that were then a one-dimensional LR model, we can easily embed that in two dimensions by adding basically one constant component to it. I hope that comes clear. After rotating this, right? So that's in a nutshell what's going to happen in the following, okay? So, but, you know, before I do that, and we really wanted to be sure that we do not miss anything, right? So we gave a very weak type of relation, right? So what is the weakest possible? So we say, okay, I mean, right, so we speak about an LG and an LR or two LR models, therefore. So we said, and let's formalize. So take another LR model, which of dimension M prime. So again, components, number of components, M prime, which is just the same as the original LR model, but with primes everywhere. And then we say, okay, this model here is observationally equivalent to the original one if their state price densities normalized coincide, right? Because that's the weakest possible we need. Because if the state price density normalized coincide, then all asset prices coincide, right? And so they produce the same economy, okay? Good. Okay, so it's kind of important because, mathematically it gives you quite a bit of work. We do not just say, okay, let's look at another model, LR model, which comes from the original one by an affine transformation, right? We say, right? Right, because of course we prove then that from this identity, right, Z prime essentially has to be an affine transformation of Z, but that's kind of the, you know, that's kind of dealing with the fine properties and it's rather elaborate. Okay, elementary but elaborate. Fine. So this is the definition, and so then the first step we do here in this context, in this flow of narrative that I give you here, we just redefine now what an LG process is. In a sense, you know, what I showed you in the first section where we reviewed Gabay's original definition, we just embed it into the context of, into the framework of LR models, right? An LG process is an LR model with zero constant drift part and zero phi, right? How about that, right? That should be clear now to everyone. So just that, right? And yet it's a bit more generic, a bit more flexible than the original definition, right? So that's an LG process. So an LG process is an LR model with zero B and zero. And let me write down for the sake of, you know, having these expressions in front. Let me write down the generic LR model. I think this is always coming with this number 2.1 produced by LaTeX. So can you see it? Sorry. Yes.
Was the C process the sender or the X process? Like 10 years ago.
I think they modeled the Z process then. Also. Yes, they modeled the C process. But struggling because Z was the mean reverting to zero all the time, and then it caused problems. Okay. So, LG process, right? Is a special case of an LR. Good. And conversely now, right, the LR model that I just wrote down here, right, this LR model, right, of course I can just, you know, I can obviously, you know, this guy, this drift here becomes linear in the augmented process when I just add constant one to it, right? Call Z prime, stacked one with Z, and then Z prime will have a linear drift. And zeta will load linearly, strictly linearly on Z prime. Right? So augmenting the dimension, going to this situation, in other words, right? So we start with an LR, and now, okay, this, I should rotate this hyperplane or this affine subspace, and I should just make one the first component and Z the second component. And then we have an LG process, but living on an affine subset, okay? So that's right? But of course, now the question, right? This goes only after embedding it in a higher dimensional space, right? The question now, you know, does there exist an observationally equivalent LG process of the same dimension? Right? Can we make, is that an LG process of the same dimension in disguise or not? Right? And the answer is, well, guess what, right? It's no, right? The answer is no, yes. And so, as a first step towards, right? So the first thing is you may guess the answer is yes, right? Because, okay, you say here we have a non-zero B, we have a non-zero phi. At least one of them we can make easily zero at the time, right? By just applying an affine transformation to it. And here it is, right? I mean, we just shift that by some vector Q, right? And then we subtract Q here, we add Q back in the expression for zeta, and then of course whenever we choose Q such that phi plus psi Q gives zero, right, then, you know, we have new coordinates where the phi here is zero, okay? So phi becomes zero, like I indicated here, and that's obviously, right, something observationally equivalent. Now this is without loss of generality, we could assume phi is zero, but I do not recommend it, right? And it's because of the specification story, right? Right? If zeta was to be strictly positive, right? So we rather keep phi here strictly positive, i.e. equal to 1, and let phi psi z be non-negative, right? So there's no point in shifting the positive autant by something just that, you know, that we get the zero phi here in this expression down there. Okay. And objection here, right? And the second one is, right, fine. Such a Q we can obviously always find, right? But can we then also find a Q such that the B prime, right, is still here, right? There's still a constant in the drift, right? Can we also find a Q so that B prime is zero And that's the answer is no, right? Because this is M, there are M constraints, and this is of, so the answer is no. And that would be required to make that prime an LG process. So then, you know, that's just a corollary, right? If we had a Q so that both of them were zero, then we had an LG process, right? And so we now call LR models which do not have such a Q, we call them proper, right? This will be the LR models which cannot just after shifting or any affine transformation be turned into an LG process of the same dimension proper, right? So, or in other words, so far what we have seen, a non-proper LR model is observationally equivalent to an LG process of the same dimension. And actually the converse holds true as well, right? Okay. However, right, but I will skip it for the sake of time. We have to deal a bit with the dimension reduction here, because again, right? So I'm quite relaxed on the dimension to start with. The dimension is just the number of components of Z, right? Now suppose we start with a one-dimensional LR model that gives us everything, right? And now I take my favorite 10-dimensional CIR process and I just stack it to the original Z. Then I have an 11-dimensional process, but these 10 additional dimensions do not show up at all in the price, right? It's kind of a trivial way of making Z 11-dimensional, even though effectively it's a one-dimensional thing. So in a sense, we have to get rid of these redundant dimensions that could be there, right? So and the way we do it is we just checked which of the directions actually show up in the term structure equation. Right, and all those who are redundant, we can then actually transform away. So that's the content of this slide here. But again, I will not go into the details here. Right, so we can always assume that we have an effective dimension. And in this case, right, indeed, right, properness is equivalent to there exists no observational equivalent m-dimensional LG, right, of the same dimension, right. Right. On top of it, in this case, also there exists no lower dimensional observational equivalent LR model. Right. We cannot. So it's really okay. We really need all the M components. Okay. So that shows that there are LR models in dimension M which are not LG processes of dimension M. Right.
I got lost somewhere. So if in one dimension, if your term structure is generated by an LG process directly.
Yes.
In one dimension.
Yes.
Then there's a corresponding LR model, right?
It itself is an LR model, right? Every LG process in itself is an LR model.
This is not proper in this case in one dimension.
Well, because it's an LG process itself. It's proper if it's not an LG process. Properness means not being an LG, right? Properness B means, you know, the B and the phi here, they are really essential, right? They cannot be omitted. Proper LR model is not observation equivalent to an LG. Okay. And if you start with an LG, which is an LR model, then of course it's observationally equivalent to itself, so it's not proper. Okay? Okay. But they are, right? And in a sense, this is kind of reminiscent of this. I mean, don't look at the details, but just read the title. There are non-proper LR models that are observationally equivalent to lower dimensional LR models, right? I.e., these are typically LG processes, right? And such LG processes you call reducible, right? So there an M-dimensional LG process for which there exists a lower dimensional LR model, observationally equivalent, is called reducible. Right. Again, this is the situation, right? We start with a one-dimensional LR. We embed it in one dimension higher. It becomes LG, right? And so this is a reducible LG process, right? Because it's a lower dimensional LR model in this case, and that indeed is the case. And we can characterize, right? So, and I mean, this theorem here tells us this is the generic situation where this happens, right? LG processes which are reducible are of this form, right? They are a lower dimensional LR model, right? But, you know, which is augmented by one constant and lives therefore on this affine hyperplane. We can, I mean, what is a bit more, so you see an e to the alpha, and that of course means that, you know, there's a direction v, right? So that, you know, the scalar product of v and z is constant, okay? Okay. Now, of course, you know, you remember in the LG processes, we can always inflate them with an exponential lambda t that we just trade off when we then define the state price density. So in that sense, right, we can move it exponentially, this hyperplane, right? But that we can easily stabilize, right? And this is what is expressed here. So an LG process, right, i.e. a process of this form, let's say in dimension 2, m is 2, right, is reducible if and only if, right, this actually, it looks like this, right, after possibly taking care of inflation in a fixed direction here. Okay? Good. So that's what the corollary also says, in other words. Okay, good. So now, you know, and here is, oh yeah, and then of course there's one question. So what do then there exist LG processes that are not reducible, right? Right? Again, right? It's kind of, and yes, the answer is yes. There are LG processes which are not reducible, so they are generic LG. They're genuinely LG, and this is not an LR of lower dimension in disguise. Okay, this also exists, right? So, you know, but that's the full picture, right? So there are LG processes which are reducible, and there are LG processes which are genuine LG processes, okay? Now, which of them are really, you know, are these reducible LG processes, are these just accidents, or do they happen to play an important role? Are they distinct in some sense, or are they just accidents? Now the answer is, and that's the last part will be, in the context of long-term factorization, the reducible LG processes are the ones. You can only have this type of long-term factorization for the reducible LG processes. Okay. And so let me explain you in a few minutes what this long-term risk factorization is about. I think this is also interesting for the house here itself, because Winton is about long-term investing, so cares about long-term risk, and so here is the story. So first thing is, you know, we look at forward measures here, right? This is, first of all, it's about forward measures, right? So remember, so now in a sense, the next three, four slides, they are not related to LR or LG processes, right? So this is, just take a state price density of the form as I showed you on the scope slide, right? So there's an auxiliary, there's a reference measure P star. And the best here is probably even to think of P star, okay. And then, you know, the T forward measure is what? Well, the T forward measure is what you get by, you know, by changing the numerator, right? By replacing the risk-free discount factor replacing the state price density by basically the T-bond price, right? And this is then achieved by this Radon-Nikodym derivative, right, which is given here, right? Okay, and as a consequence, right, because every asset price process S, right, is after multiplication with the state price density, by definition, a martingale under P star. Of course, with this definition, it then easily follows that the price process discounted by this new numerator, the zero, the T bond, is a martingale under T forward measure. That's kind of standard stuff. So T forward measure. Now, what about T is finite time horizon here? What about letting T going to infinity, right? And that brings us to the long forward measure. But in order that this works, right, this martingale here, which is indexed by capital T, right, must make sense for capital T to infinity. And that has been worked out. And there is a beautiful paper by Keen and Linetsky, published last year again, who really makes that very clear and nicely understandable. Says that, you know, if this family of martingales here, indexed by capital T, if this converges, you know, point-wise, T-wise, you know, in L1 to something which is strictly positive, then, you know, this strictly positive limit here is itself a martingale and defines the long forward measure. that's the long forward measure. Caveat here, right? Things are a bit non-trivial because, you know, if you remember the forward rate identity, which tells you that the instantaneous forward rate is the expectation on the T forward measure of the future spot rate, right? This holds not under the long forward measure anymore. It's not so that the long forward rate is equal to the expectation under the long forward measure of the future spot rate. It's not. It does not hold. Okay, because there are two T's here, right? T shows up there, capital T, and so. Fine. Just a side remark. Okay, but importantly is, you know, suppose now the long forward measure exists, so this condition be satisfied, then we can define what is called the long bond, and that's just the ratio. It's just the gross return of a dollar investment in the zero coupon bond with maturity T within a time, you know, with a time step small t, right? So we let capital T go to infinity. This ratio here, you know, this limit exists in probability, and this gives us the long bond. This is the gross return earned, again, on the investment of a dollar at time zero in an infinite maturity bond, okay? And that's about, you know, that's about telling us, you know, how do we evaluate the cash flow at infinite time horizon, right? How do you evaluate the cash flow at infinite time horizon? And the change in this long bond is changing us, is telling us how our perceptions of the long-term risk changes, right? So this is about long-term risk, right? And by the way, right, this long bond is also the growth optimal portfolio under the long forward measure. That's just an easy consequence of Jensen's inequality, okay? So it's a nice concept. And then we just re-express then zeta itself, right, in terms of now the long bond and this martingale, the density process of the long forward measure. And then we get this decomposition, and that's the long-term factorization. That's the long-term risk factorization, which decomposes zeta now into what is called a transitory component and a permanent component. Permanent component is just the Radon-Nikodym derivative of the long forward measure with respect to our auxiliary measure, and the transitory component is the rest. Okay? So, and the transitory component, therefore, right? Now think, now comes the advantage, right? I told you that the auxiliary measure P star could be anything between P and Q, right? Suppose P star was equal to L, the long forward measure, right? Of course, in this case, M here would be 1, okay? And this would just be the state price density itself, okay? So this first factor is the state price density with respect to the long forward measure, therefore. And it prices long-term risk. Again, it comes because of, you know, this long bond measures the value of cash flows taking place, you know, our pension payments, which will happen somewhere in infinite time from now, right, this is how you assess these cash flows. It prices long-term risk. The permanent component here now, if we move away from L, and now best think that P star is actually equal to P, then this is actually the risk premium, right, that you earn on the expected rate of return on any asset above the risk premium, above the return of the long bond, right? It's kind of this multiplicative decomposition here, of course, gives us an additive composition of the risk premium that we earn on the return of any asset in this economy. Okay. Good. So far, now you know. how about the situation? I told you, right? Imagine that P star is equal to L, right? But now. And that's exactly what actually we would like to do now, right? So, because with this decomposition, right, it's kind of obvious how to model, how to really capture and how to specify a model that speaks about long-term risk and the short-term risk, right? So if I want to have a model that speaks about these two components explicitly, I want to have a model which gives me the state price density under the long forward measure. I want to specify the transitory component, right? And then after having done that and done all the pricing here, because I just take P's, L expectations, right, of stuff that I multiply with the state price density. Then, of course, when we then interested in the real world dynamics, then I can always just specify exogenously a permanent component that gives me the rest of the risk premium. Okay, so that's what a good model is, right? And so now, therefore, you know, first thing we ask, when is, right, given a model for a state price density, so when is it that P star is equal to L? When is it? Well, and here it is, right? It follows from the definition here, right? It is, of course, it is if M infinity, if this martingale here is 1. So if this limit here goes, is 1, right? So, and that's just boils down to this. So, and now you see, right? So this is like a statement, about mean reversion of the factor process, right? Mean reversion. And now, right, now comes the troubles and with LG, right? LG processes, you know, the mean reverting property of them is hard to capture and actually, well, is actually such that it brings us exactly to this situation if we want that to be true, right? That's our main finding, right? So this is happening in an LG process specification of zeta exactly when the LG process is of this form, when it's a lower dimensional LR model in disguise. Okay, and that's the main result. And I skipped this one because we also say something about the long-term yield, but I skipped that one. And this is the main result here, right? So the LG process, m-dimensional LG process, P star is equal to L, right? So the state price density is with respect to the long forward measure only if the LG process is reducible, right? It is of this form. And then there's a statement about the long-term yield, but that's, you know, you can look up yourself. And then again, right, we give an example where this does not hold, right? So we give an example of a non-reducible LG process for which indeed P star is not equal to L, and also the long-term yield is actually even random, right? And the idea of this proof is again, and I, you know, I don't give any details, but again, right, is this property, right? P star is equal to L if this holds, right? And then plugging in, right, we have of course closed form expressions for this numerator denominator, and you know that eventually brings us to the situation which is reminiscent of the characterization of when is an LG process reducible in terms of you know, there is a direction. If we take the scalar product, right? So with respect to this direction, so that has to live in a family of hyperplanes, right? That is orthogonal to some direction, inflated by some exponential lambda t. All right, that's it. So as I showed you, after having reviewed LG processes, LR models, right? They are essentially the same. LR models are LG processes and vice versa. Modulo this dimensionality story here, right? I.e., every LR model includes an LG process by adding a constant to it. Conversely, right, this gives us reducible LG processes which are of this form. And LR models are in turn important representations of LG processes because they can be easily specified, and moreover, right, they are the natural choice when we want to model under the long-term factorization. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions or comments? Yes,
Johan. Maybe naive, so Cesar Spark by Peter Carr and you, and before by Stephen Ross. Can this anyhow be embedded? Ross is discrete time, but
for the recovery theorem, right?
Yes,
that's the recovery theorem. That is not specifically to do with LG processes or LR models.
So there's no LG interpretation.
But they elaborate on the point that you know this recovery theorem that Ross actually proposed that was true under the long forward measure.
Yes.
Right? So the conclusion that was true was true under the assumption that long forward measure is the reference measure, is the auxiliary measure or the reference measure. He thought it was the objective measure, is the long forward measure. Right? And then later, Peter Carr was then first generalizing the discrete or the finite state result to infinite state and continuous state. But then Shankman and some people from Chicago actually proved that the conclusion was not that straightforward if you take account of the permanent component in the state price density.
But there was never an LG interpretation in this.
No, that LG or LR is already a specific class of models, right? But what they did was model, in that sense, more model free. Yes.
Anything else? Have you tried calibration in the long-term factorization setting?
Yes, we did that. We did that, and in fact, that's what we did in this paper that I mentioned at the beginning, in our paper that was published last year in the Journal of Finance.
Cool.
Thanks to Anders Trolle, the co-author, who is an empirical asset pricer. So he actually carried out an extensive empirical part and we used this decomposition. We were not aware yet of the long forward measure, but we were multiplying to our state price density. We were multiplying an auxiliary component that gave us then the step from the auxiliary measure to the real world measure. Yes. And it helped a lot, right? So if you want to fit, if you want to do time series fitting, so if you want to fit the risk premia, then you have to do the full specification. You have to multiply with that's a permanent component.
Nothing else to expect from here again. Thank you very much.